In this video, I want to share with you a very important pattern when it comes to data fetching in your React applications that you should apply to your own projects if you can, at least most of the time. This is a pattern that we use extensively in my Advanced Patterns React course, which this video is trying to help promote. So if you're interested to hear more about the course, the first link in the description is for you. Now let's get into the video and let's talk about the data fetching pattern. So over here, we have a pretty standard, pretty typical example of a component that is fetching some data using React Query. We have our post query here, we're using the use query hook, passing it a query key, query function, and then we're using the actual data in the body of the component. And then over here, we have this root constant over here, which is coming from TanStackRouter, which is our navigation library. This is going to become relevant a little bit later when I show you the actual pattern. Now, this code over here, as I've said, is pretty typical, right? I'm sure that you've seen this code in a lot of applications, and I'm sure that you've also written this code in a lot of your applications. I certainly have. But even if this code is so typical, and even if there's technically nothing wrong with it, I would still argue that you shouldn't do this in your React applications if you can. Now, I'm not talking about the small optimizations that you can do, for example, coming here and creating a custom hook for this in case you want to reuse it, like I talked about in previous videos, or even coming here and actually creating a component for the post. That's not what I'm talking about. This is a very simple example, and it's just for the video. What I'm talking about specifically is where and how we are actually fetching our data, where we're calling React Query, and how we're handling our loading and error states. Doing it this way, I would advise against, again, if you can. And here's why. What we're doing here is we're handling all of our data fetching inside of our component. We're calling useQuery here inside of the index component, then we're checking is pending also inside of the component, and we're doing the same thing for is error. And this has two drawbacks. The first drawback is that this bloats the component to handle all of these is pending and is error cases, and actually can slow down the performance of the component over time. Because if you look at the way that we're using this useQuery over here, because we're using it inside of the component, on the initial first render of the index component, our post query, the data for that post query, the actual post, is going to be undefined because the fetch hasn't yet happened. So we're going to get a whole render of the component in an undefined state. And then we're going to go here to this is pending flag because is pending is going to be true on that first render. And then and only then are we going to fetch the actual data to fetch our post. Now, our post might already be in the cache because maybe we fetched it someplace else. But let's assume that that's not the case, because even if it was, you still have the same problem. On that first render, the actual data is undefined. And then once you actually get the data back from this API call, either actually fetching from the API or it being returned from the cache, then you're going to get a re-render of this component, and now you're going to have your data. Which, I mean, is fine. Like, it's not that bad, right? You have one query, and then you have one re-render, and then you have your data. It's not that bad. But this can become a problem if you have multiple queries, you're fetching multiple things at different times, and all of these things are coming here, and they're going to cause a component to re-render multiple times. Because let's say, for example, you want to fetch the comments, right? So we can do const, and then we can do comments query, and I have here a function that is going to fetch the comments. Let's say that now we also have this comments query that is also going to fetch based on the post ID. Now, granted, you could probably put this someplace else in another component and you wouldn't have this problem, but sometimes you can't, and sometimes you have to put multiple queries in the same component. Now, what's going to happen is on that first render, both of these are going to be undefined. Then they're both going to actually fetch their data, and then both of them are going to independently come and actually re-render the component. So now you have two re-renders in your component. Every single query that you add has more re-renders to your component. And then if you're using the default values of React Query, then every single time that you actually go away from the browser, come back to the browser, you're going to trigger the focus event on the browser that is going to refetch all of the queries. If there's new data, it's going to cause a couple of re-renders to your component. And you can quickly see that this is going to degrade the performance of your component if every single time that something happens, it has to re-render multiple times. But even then, that's not that bad, because re-renders are cheap, right? And if you have everything else optimized, if you're using the React compiler, it's not that bad. But there's another problem that actually comes with this approach. And that that is because all of these things are undefined here. Well, first of all, you have to check is pending over here, right? And if you now want to also include the comments in your is pending, you have to come here and you also have to add the comments query to is pending. Now, maybe you don't. Maybe your user experience for your application does not want to hold up the entire rendering of this component if the comments query is pending. Maybe you want to defer that to simply self-send the component, and that's fine, right? But again, you still have to add complexity inside of your component, which is going to bloat it up with a lot of code. If you then want to add an error over here, well, you can add it. And now you're going to see here, I actually forgot to remove this now, because if I don't put the error over here, you're going to see that we have no type errors here, because TypeScript is smart enough to infer that if we have post query dot is error, then we're going to have an error dot message. But if we actually put the comments query here, now we no longer have this, and we have to put a question mark here to use optional chaining to actually get the error message. And then if we actually want to, because this doesn't make sense, right? We have our post query here and we're only showing the error of the post. But what if the comments has an error? Then we also have to put the comments error over here. So you might do something like this. And now you can quickly see that our component is starting to get really complicated and we only have two queries over here. And then if you want to add multiple queries, you want to have derived values from the queries, like for example, taking the post query and then getting some derived value from it, you're going to have to check undefined, you're going to have to put a default value, and you're always going to get that first render with undefined and all of your values not working because you're fetching the data inside of your component. And basically, until the data is fetched, your component is going to have undefined for everything. And that's generally bad from a pattern standpoint, from a clean code standpoint, because now you're polluting the component with all of this data fetching, when really data fetching doesn't really belong inside of the component. Because if you usually think about data fetching, like think about when you actually need to fetch some data. When do you need to fetch a data to show it to the user? Usually it's in a response to a navigation event, right? The user goes to some page, goes to actually check something on your application, goes to that URL is then going to render things and show them that data, right? The data fetching usually in most cases, not all the time, but in most cases, is dependent on navigation. But this component over here is not directly part of the navigation. Yes, this is the component that is rendered on that specific URL, but it's not the one that is actually handling all of that navigation. What's handling our navigation is this root over here, a stack router, our navigation solution. And so what ends up happening, and this is also another drawback of doing it this way, not only are you getting more complex code inside of your component, but also usually navigation libraries are going to code split your actual files, your components, and only load them asynchronously as needed. In the case of TanStack Router, even if you only have one page in your application, TanStack Router is going to load all of this code over here, which is going to need some inherent JavaScript code in the bundle to actually run all the navigation stuff. And then it's going to lazy load the actual component and then render the component, which means that for your data fetching to actually happen, you first need to also wait for the bundle of the component to be loaded in the user's browser to then trigger the fetch to fetch the data. So not only are you starting with an undefined state and you're complicating the component, but you also have to wait for the bundle to be loaded to actually even begin the fetching process. This is slow, and this is as slow as it can be. And this is a big problem with traditional single page applications. And that's why you have now solutions like TanStack Router, like React Router, and others that are giving you access to different ways to fetch your data outside of your React components to basically eliminate all of these drawbacks. And let me show you what I mean. And this is now the pattern that you should implement in your applications. You want to come here, and now this is going to depend completely on what you're using as your navigation library. Here I'm using TanStack Router, but it's probably going to be the same with React Router. They just might have a different API. Regardless, it's still the same concept. They will usually provide you a sort of loader function that you can use to actually run some code before the component ever gets rendered, before the bundle of the component ever gets loaded. And that's the place where you can actually prefetch your data and make it available directly to your component as soon as it's ready to start mounting. Right, so here we have a loader and we can let Cursor kind of help us out here. What we can do, and again, this is specific to TanStack Router. This is not a TanStack Router video. We're getting the query client here, which TanStack Router, you can inject the context here. And because we're using React Query, we can actually use the query client and then prefetch a query based on a query key. So we can prefetch the data that we know we're going to need inside of this component, because again, this root is tied to that component. So we know that we're going to need to consume consume that data inside of the component, we can prefetch it and then make it ready for the component as soon as it's ready to mount. And this should actually be await here because we want to await the actual prefetch and not render the component until we have our prefetching done. And now what we can do is we can also come here and maybe prefetch the actual comments. Now, usually I would do this inside of a promise.all. So let's see, can cursor do it, await promise.all. There you go. Just to make these in parallel because you don't need one to depend on the other, right? So it's generally better to do it this way. You can now await if you want, right? Both the post and the comments. You don't necessarily have to do that. Maybe you don't want to prefetch the comments as well. It completely depends on the user experience that you want to have for the application. But now you can prefetch this data. And now by the time this component is rendered here, you know that you already have the data because it's been pre-populated in the cache. Now this means that here, you're gonna have to make some changes. You're no longer going to be using useQuery directly. You're gonna be using useSuspenseQuery, which is another hook from ReactQuery. And here we're gonna put it at the comments as well. What this is going to do, this useSuspenseQuery, and this is going to defer the loading and the error states and all of the fetching to the nearest suspense boundary and let it handle loading the fallback and actually getting the data to this component. Now, this suspense boundary is actually not visible to us because we're not the ones managing it. It's actually TanSec router that is creating around every single route in your application, a suspense boundary that is going to show a pending component, a fallback, until this loader here finishes executing. So until our data here is prefetched, our suspense boundary is gonna be triggered at the router level, and only once the data is ready, are we then going to get our component with the data already there. And what's cool about this is that now, because we're using useSuspenseQuery, we no longer need to check for his pending because the data has already been fetched by this point. We no longer need to check for his error because our error is not going to be handled inside of this component. And now our post query is always going to have data. And so there's no longer going to be any re-renders of our component because the data is already there. Instead, our loading and error states are going to be handled inside of the navigation library, right? In the example of TanStack router, I can come in here and I can do pending component and I can put anything here for a pending component. I can come in here and I can put an error component and also show an error component. Now, as long as this is not resolved, as long as our fetches are still going on, this pending component is going to load, which is going to be the fallback of the suspense boundary that TanSec router implements. And then if we have an error in any of these fetches, which may happen, you never know, now we're also handling here inside of this component. We're no longer doing any of this inside of our main React component. Our component now is only responsible for receiving the data, right, through React Query, and then just displaying the data. It no longer handles loading, no longer handles error, and it's a much simpler component, and there's a lot less code in your component. Right, so we made this component simpler, we improved the performance and the amount of re-renders of our component, and we actually improved the general performance of our application because now we're fetching the data as soon as we actually want to visit a root instead of waiting for the bundle to load, for that root to load, for the component to mount, and then to trigger a fetch. This is much better. And in most cases, you want to do this because, like I said, most of the time, the data that you want to fetch is going to be a result of some navigation that your user is going to take. So if your data is based on navigation, put it in the loader and get it outside of your React components. Now, I really mean it when I say most of the time, because sometimes you don't necessarily want to do this. And I'm going to show an example. Going back to our comments here, let's say that we don't want to do this and we actually don't want to hold up the entire loading of the page until we also have our comments. Maybe we want the comments to be fetched after the component mounts, just because that's what we want for our user experience. We only care about the post to be there and only later do we want to fetch the comments asynchronously. In that case, we can come here, we can actually remove the comments and we can remove the promise.all and we can just directly prefetch the data of the post and not worry about the comments. Now in the comments over here, we're gonna have to come and remove suspense query because they haven't been prefetched. And now our comments are gonna be undefined and we can also get the actual loading and we're gonna have to handle loading. So let's say, for example, we can come in here and we can just make a check, right? We can do comments query.data and then we can put a question mark here. And let's say that we are fine with the comments being undefined on that first render. We can maybe show a spinner here. We can maybe show a pending component, whatever we want to do. And we can defer that loading to a later point. This is also fine, right? And again, you don't have to put everything inside of a loader, just the things that you want specifically for that route. And this greatly varies and it depends on the user experience that you want to have for your application. And of course, again, I just want to re-mention it. You could always put this in a separate component, worry about the loading in a separate component, make that component reusable, right? This is just a simple example for the tutorial video. So don't focus on the specific semantics of what I'm showing here. Focus on the concept, which is if you need data for navigation, put it in your navigation and load it in the loader. So yeah, that's the pattern. It's a really powerful pattern. It simplifies things a lot and it greatly improves the performance of your application. And this is a pattern that we use extensively in Advanced Patterns React. We use it for every single one of our routes and we go much deeper. We're actually using TRPC. So we're piping everything through TRPC. We're prefetching things, we're invalidating things, we're checking for authentication in our loaders, and we're basically preparing our components to be as simple as possible so we can just have many components and not really worry about it. And really, that's the whole point of the course. We spent a lot of time focusing on building good, clean design patterns that basically allow us to build any amount of features super easily and at scale. With the patterns that you learn in the course, you can literally build and implement any feature that you want in a matter of minutes, really, because it is that simple. And you can also scale this to many developers, right? If you onboard developers, if you have clean patterns like this, it makes it really easy for new developers to come in, look at the code, and immediately know how they can get something done, how they can add a new feature to the code base. And that's really important because that's how senior developers essentially write their code. They focus on good patterns, their code is clean, reusable, easy to understand, and it just scales. It scales in terms of features and it scales in terms of developers. And that's what this course is all about. You're gonna learn how to think like a senior developer, you're gonna learn how to write code like a senior developer, and you're finally going to level up your React skill level and get past that intermediate level. If you want to know more about the course, it's coming out on April 17th, and there's a waitlist that you can join for it right now. It'll be the first link in the description. I'm honestly super excited for this course. There's so many patterns that I put in there. I literally poured my heart and soul and all the knowledge that I had in there. And I'm very excited for you to see it, for you to go on this adventure with me and to really help you get to the next level of React development. So once again, check out the waitlist. It's going to be the first link in the description. There you go. That's it. That's all I have for this video. If you enjoyed it, leave a like, subscribe. You can also click here to watch a different video of mine. And I will see you in the next video. Ciao, ciao.